Well, I think in the interest of time, we will get started. So just wanted to say good afternoon to everyone and to welcome you to the second in our series of three workshops with Marita Golden, who's become a friend to the Office of Diversity, Inclusion, and Health Equity and the Office of Well-Being. And today our session is focused on saving our children. And we thought it was really important in the session in October, which was during Employees with Disabilities Awareness Month, we talked about the importance of addressing mental health as an invisible disability in our community and in our workplace in general, but thought it would be really important to have a session specifically focused on our children and our adolescents because they have been through a lot during the pandemic and a lot of sort of celebratory milestones that they've had. Were pretty much altered in ways that were unanticipated, and that has the potential to have consequences, not just in the short term but long term. So we thought this was important. So I am going to introduce Marita Golden, and again, this is an event co-sponsored by the Office of Well-Being and the Office of Diversity, Inclusion, and Health Equity. Dr. Bittison, since her regret, she had a conflict. But Marita Golden, who many of us know now well, is the author of 19 books of fiction and nonfiction, including her most recent work of nonfiction, The Strong Black Woman: How a Myth Endangers the Physical and Mental Health of Black Women. She's the recipient of many awards, including the Writers for Writers Award presented by Barnes & Noble and Poets and Writers, an award from the Authors Guild, and the Fiction Award for her novel After, awarded by the Black Caucus of the American Library Association. She has lectured and read from her work internationally. And as a literary consultant, she offers writing workshops, coaching, and manuscript evaluation services. She also has appointments at several universities. So I am going to turn it over to my friend and colleague, Marita Golden.
Thank you. I'm so glad to be here again. This is feeling like home, and I'm glad to be here again with my friend and colleague, Dr. Pamela Brewer. And just by way of introduction, Dr. Pamela Brewer is a psychotherapist who received her PhD in social psychology from Union Institute and University in Cincinnati, Ohio. She's a board-certified licensed clinical social worker with over 30 years of postgraduate clinical experience. She's published many articles and made appearances on many radio and TV programs, local and national TV programs, discussing mental health issues, including marital health, the existence and healing from domestic violence, elder abuse, trauma, depression, healthy relationships, self-esteem, and more. And she also has a program, Mind Talk with Dr. Pamela Brewer, which originated in 1995. And I think, Pamela, you're still on YouTube. Are you on YouTube?
I haven't updated it in a while, but I am on YouTube and planning to update it quite soon.
Okay, great, great. Well, once again, I'm glad to be here. I'm glad we're both here. And today we're going to talk about our children. And we're talking about our children at a time of crisis. And I wanted to begin the discussion by referencing a book that I wrote back in 1995, a book called Saving Our Sons, Raising Black Children in a Turbulent World, which was published in 1995. And I'm very pleased to announce that my publisher has reissued an updated and revised version of the book with 50 pages of guidance, resources, and advice for parents, caregivers raising Black sons, Black children. I wrote this book in the midst of the crisis we were facing in the mid-90s, the epidemic of gun violence in many, many urban areas, which saw in cities like Washington, D.C., Philadelphia, Atlanta, 400 mostly young Black men killed every year. And this was a national crisis which gained which I'm so, sorry about that. I don't know how that happened, which gained attention. But at that time, we weren't talking about the mental health aspect of all this. And so I wrote Saving Our Sons in response to a question my then 15-year-old son asked me about why God would let two of his young friends be killed in incidents of gun violence. After I wrote the book and was touring across the country, I found that many white parents who attended my readings shared the fact that they had the same kind of visceral concerns about the health and even the survival of their children as well. So the book became a book that was adopted by many parents groups, community groups, and was a resource and read pretty widely. I was even on the Oprah Winfrey Show. So I'm very pleased that it's now out in a new edition. And I wanted to read one or two, probably three short sections from the book, just as a frame of reference and for parallel and to talk about how we seem to always be in a state of crisis with our young people in this country. And we can talk about some of the reasons that happens. I remember it like it was yesterday, the evening my son Michael, then in junior high school, asked the question that inspired this book. Why would God let that happen? He asked, trying to hold back tears, as he told me that a friend from his school had been shot and killed as he left a party. He was 15 years old. This was the second time he had lost a friend to gun violence. It was 1993. Some Black mother's son in this year of our Lord 2022 is asking the same question. And of course, now we know that the gun violence, the carnage is nationwide and that it crosses economics, race, class, neighborhood. And so the same question I'm sure young people are asking today. I'm sure that the young people in Uvalde ask their parents, why would God let this happen? I wrote Saving Our Sons to grieve the carnage along with my community. Back then, an average of 400 mostly young Black men a year were killing each other in major cities like the one I lived in, Washington, D.C. I wrote Saving Our Sons to connect with the chorus of concern, wisdom, and compassion that I knew still had a heartbeat where Black people live, love, and yes, die. I wrote Saving Our Sons to lift the voices of young Black men who had become, to many Americans, Black and white, anonymous statistics, part of a numbing daily death toll. I wanted to beat the drum that heralded life in the face of death. And here we are 30 years later, and we have this same situation expanded, enlarged, and however enhanced by the fact that we are now talking about saving our children, not just saving our children's lives physically, but equipping them with the mental tools that they need to survive and be healthy. One of the people that I interviewed for this book is a woman named Lenice Bias. And during that time, her son, Len Bias, was a very, very prominent star basketball player for the University of Maryland. This was in the mid-90s. And he signed a contract with the Boston Celtics, which was pretty amazing. And the night after he signed the contract, he returned home, went out with some friends, partied, and died of a cocaine overdose. And this was during the war on drugs, the just say no period. And that tragedy led Lenice Bias to become an activist and spokesperson, traveling all around the country, talking to parents, talking to children. And there's a point during the time when I interviewed her where she talked about what she had learned from talking with hundreds of young people. And as I read this little section, I want you to think about how we can translate these things she's talking about into contemporary concerns. She said, these are the six lies young people in America live by, the same lies that derail them. Her voice rearing up like an engine, Lenice Bias ticked off the lies in each finger. If I get all the material things, I'll be okay. If I join the right group, I'll be okay. If I do what the group is doing, if I disrespect adult authority, if I have sex, I'll be okay. And no one has a problem like mine. And those six mythologies or lies are now, their toxicity has been dramatized and exponentially increased by social media, by the fact that our children live in a world where they are exposed to so much and not knowing how to process a lot of what they're exposed to. So this is a book that, as I said, I'm very proud of. And for those of you who are looking for guidance, in the book, I talk to parents, young men, activists, and as I said, in this new edition, there's 50 pages of guidance and resources. So I think at this point, Pamela and I are going to have a discussion, a wide-ranging discussion covering a lot of topics. And then, of course, we're going to leave time for discussion with you, the audience, and take your questions as well as your comments. Sherita, when we were talking about the best time to have this program, mentioned that next week is actually Transgender Awareness and Transgender Day of Remembrance Week. And the remembrance part refers to remembering those transgender people who have been killed or murdered because of their gender expression. And we're going to talk about COVID, we're going to talk about mental health. But I thought it would be good, as I say, I like to say, we're going to swallow the big frog first. And the whole issue of transgender rights, transgender identity has become this hot button issue that is confusing, is puzzling, that evokes feelings that many of us are not used to having, even feelings that are even more puzzling, for example, as we've learned to accept our gay and lesbian brothers and sisters. So I wanted to talk first about the issue of transgender youth. And Pamela, we talked about, let's start with some definitions, because there's so much fear around this. The bathroom bill, you know, fear, politicians using it to divide. So let's just talk about the facts that we know, the realities around the lives of transgender youth, transgender people. So what is the definition of transgender? Let's start with that.
Okay, do you have like a month or so? Well, let me start with the, you know, what we have learned, what we've gotten used to seeing in writing, and that is the LGBTQ plus group. And that's lesbian, bisexual, transgender. I know I'm missing something. Q, it can be for questioning or queer. Uh-huh. Queer used to be a negative application to persons who were gay. Now it's sort of been reclaimed,
right.
And it's okay. It's a useful term. You know, there are many different pieces to this. Obviously, if you're lesbian, your interest is in women. You're a woman and you're interested in women. Gay, which can be either male or female, but we got comfortable with referring to gay men as gay. I'm really awake to this today. But then there was bisexual, meaning that you had an interest, a positive interest in both male and female. Transgender, transsexual, you know, those are for folks really challenging experience for those who don't feel connected to the body in which they were born. And so there's been all kinds of dire comments that they can't have surgery, they're too young to have surgery, to be able to actively transfer from the gender that they were born with to the gender that they feel most comfortable living. Not everybody who's transgender has gone through surgery. And, you know, contrary to some very negative and yet popular myths, just because you say you're transgender doesn't mean you automatically go to a doctor or a hospital and get the surgery and it's all done. There's a series of meetings and consults with doctors, with psychotherapists, with parents, etc. I think the bottom line to all of this is a entire group, particularly if these folks are of color. African American, LGBTQ members of the LGBTQ experience much more racism, much more sexism, much more violence. Mm-hmm. They're much more likely to use drugs. They're just much more at risk. And of course, you know, they're very likely to experience sexual assault. Not that everyone will, but, and I'm not going to repeat some of the things that I've heard folks say about it, but, you know, a male who thinks that the person living not inside the gender that person thinks they should live in will rape them under the auspices of, well, now you know what it's like to feel like a real woman or for a real man. And so, you know, I could go on and on, but.
But this is a backdrop when we talk about, you know, mental health that young people today are dealing with and living with that 30 years ago they weren't. And ironically, in many high schools, young people themselves are quite accepting of gender differences. The issue is with parental acceptance, institutional acceptance. And so then when there's that conflict or that tension between being accepted by your group, but laws and practices inhibiting your expression, we know the mental health issues for LGBTQ youth are quite high. And so this is a new wrinkle. When we talk about mental health, we're talking about a really big picture for young people.
Absolutely. And just so complicated. And for adults as well. I mean, you and I, Marita, talked about the fact that I've certainly had clients and you've talked to folks who, even as adults, when they chose, if they chose to come out, their employment might be in jeopardy. Their friends might be in jeopardy. Their families might reject them. If it's true for adults, imagine what it's like for children. And it happens very often. And certainly, we all know that, unfortunately, children know how to be really hurtful to other children. And with the complicating reality of having a gender that is different, a gender expression, a gender experience that is different from what somebody else thinks it should be, it becomes a nightmare for these young people. It's no wonder that the suicide completed and attempted numbers are really high with this group, but also with children. You know, a lot of times parents, you know, I could talk about this for so long, Marita, that you got to interrupt me, tell me to shut up.
Yeah.
It's a shut up point.
No, but this is a segue, I think, a good point to talk about the mental health of young people, not just in general, but also because of COVID. I want to read something at this point from the U.S. Surgeon General's report in 2020. The pandemic added to the pre-existing challenges that America's youth faced. It disrupted the lives of children and adolescents, such as in-person schooling, in-person social opportunities with peers and mentors, access to healthcare and social services, food, housing, and the health of their caregivers. The pandemic's negative impacts most heavily affected those who were vulnerable to begin with: youth with disabilities, racial and ethnic minorities, LGBTQ+, youth, low-income youth, youth in rural areas, youth in immigrant households, youth involved with the child welfare or juvenile justice systems, and homeless youth. This fall, a coalition of the nation's leading experts in pediatric health declared a national emergency in child and adolescent mental health. And I think that the impact of COVID was so deep and so far-reaching that we really can't imagine how deep and far-reaching it really was. I want to go back and close out, bring closure to the question about LGBTQ young people, and then we'll further go into this mental health issue. We talked when we were preparing for this discussion about ways that people can educate themselves about the lives and experiences of the LGBTQ plus community. And my suggestion was, there's a fantastic 6-part documentary that was on FX, and actually it is still available, and it's called Pride. And it's a history of the lives of gay people from the 1950s to the present time. And it documents the reality of the ways that people were jailed, subjected to violence, kicked out of employment, marginalized in communities because they were gay. And the beautiful thing about that documentary is that it is deeply representative. The voices of Black, Asian, Latinx, gay people is all over the film. Their history is woven into this. So that I found that film, which is called Pride, I mean, I thought I was pretty well informed about gay life, gay people, but it was just amazing. It was completely impactful and so educational in terms of what has really happened historically and generation after generation to gay people in this country. So my recommendation would be that film. And Pamela, did you have a recommendation for people just wanting to educate themselves or be more aware, particularly about youth?
You know, PFLAG.org is a wonderful organization, and you can just look it up online for parents as well as children and adult children. But what PFLAG offers parents, you know, there are support groups, there's information. So if you as a parent have a child who's come to you and said, I think I'm gay, I might be gay, I don't know what I am, PFLAG is a great place to go. And genderspectrum.org, again, it's an organization that looks at the range of sexual expression experiences and what families can do. And you know, I'll also suggest that folks take a look at an interview that I did, and it's on Mind Talk on YouTube, and that's MYNDTALK with Dr. Pamela Brewer. And the interview was with a researcher by the name of Dr. Rich Savin Williams. I think I'm remembering his name correctly. And he talks a lot about what the experiences are for the children as well as for the adults, and really echoes what you said, Marita, in terms of young people being a lot more accepting, older people often not so much. The Trevor Project, that's the last recommendation that I would make. The Trevor Project also had, first of all, it has an escape button, which means there are a few sites that have immediate escape button. So if you are looking at that site and somebody comes in the room and you want to get away from that site immediately, you hit a button and you're done, you're gone. So you feel safer. Because sometimes people don't even feel safe looking at the material. But the Trevor Project offers a great deal of information and support to children, to adolescents, and to parents. Those are the places that I would suggest.
Mm-hmm. Okay, great.
These people starting with.
Yeah, and there's a whole section in Saving Our Sons of resources
great.
For LGBTQ Black males. Now moving forward to the question of mental health, and I want to start with two anecdotes. I did a Zoom presentation when the book Saving Our Sons was reissued, and I wanted to make sure if I was talking about Can We Save the Children, that I had a very diverse group. So I had my son. I had my husband, who was a high school teacher during that time, who had intimate daily contact with youth. I had a brilliant young woman who's a social media guru and knows a lot about the impact of social media on youth. And I had another therapist, and I had my grandson, my 17-year-old grandson, who at that time was a senior graduating. And he had gone through the pandemic, but he had gone through and he had managed to come out with flying colors. He got $250,000 in scholarship money. He was salutatorian of his class. He would complain to me, "Ma Rita, I'm so bored. I'm losing my mind. When are we going to be able to go?" But he managed. He was an athlete. He had a support system. He had focus that allowed him to be very resilient in the face of those challenges. So he was on the program, and I asked him, and I'm so glad I asked him this question. And I think it's so important that when we're talking to young people, if we are the parents of young people, if we're the aunts and uncles of young people, that we ask them tough questions. We have to talk to them the same way we would talk to our peers. And I asked him, I said, "Vaughn, do you know anybody, do you have any friends who ever talked to you about committing suicide?" And he just shook his head and said, "Ma Rita, I have so Rita," said Marita, "I have so many friends." He told me about friends who were engaged in cutting. He told me about friends who talked with him about depression and, yes, wanting to kill themselves. And I asked him, how did he keep his equilibrium? And he said that one of his sources of equilibrium was that there was a counselor at his school, and he could go to her office and he could just unload. He could just vent, and she would listen. And he said, I asked him, I said, "What do you wish parents knew about the lives of young people?" He said, "I wish they knew that they should just talk to us normal. And listen to us. Just talk to us normal, not the rating, how your grades, but ask us the questions that really matter, and that not be afraid to." And then the second anecdote is my 11-year-old granddaughter, who is one of these sort of black girl magic super leader types at 10, and her play cousin slipped her a note in class one day. And the note said that she wanted to kill herself. And so my granddaughter knew that what she had to do was take that note and give it to the teacher. And the teacher then got that young girl the kind of support she needed. But those are two young people who have the kind of emotional support, the kind of confidence that they can actually be a resource to other children. But I just thought that whole conversation with my grandson, and I got that information from my 10-year-old granddaughter by asking her, "Do you know anyone who's ever said they wanted to kill themselves?" And she was just, "Oh yeah." So let's talk about how we
You know, one of the things that certainly many adults have fallen prey to is the myth that an adult life is hard. Kids don't have any problems. And, you know, how many of us have heard adults say to their children, if their child is upset, "I'll give you something to cry about. Your life is great." Right?
Exactly.
But the reality is that children have so much exposure to so many complicated things from both ends, from their peers, from the educators, from their parents, from their social groups. And unlike adults, they don't believe and often don't have the resources to go to. So when you think about a child wanting to kill themselves, that's very real. And you know, a lot of people say, well, that's just a reach for attention. Reach for attention or not, it's real. When you think about a child, when I hear about children cutting themselves, I start to wonder if there's any abuse in the home. And that, you know, that's a whole other issue. But children in a lot of ways are hurting. And sometimes, you know, the idea that they could actually live to be 20, that's amazing. They don't believe that. So they'll do the gangs, they'll do whatever it is, they'll isolate, they'll do the things that they think will keep them safe. And some of that, as you said earlier, is about joining the right group. And the right group might actually be the worst group. I would like for all of us who have interactions with children, first of all, to recognize that they're not short adults. They really are children. And that means they don't have the wherewithal and the resources and the thinking skills to sort of think through things. But also that listening to a child, as your grandson said, a lot of times children aren't listened to. Or the person who is listening thinks that their concerns are trivial. You know, I don't have anybody to go to the prom with. An adult will say, really, that's not a problem. Can you pay my mortgage? That's not fair. Because for that child, it means something. So I would say the most important gift and the place to start is with listening to your child and recognizing that what he or she is bringing to the table is critically important to them. And therefore, it needs to be important to you.
Yeah. I mean, and I think also we have to let children know that we have to know that we can talk to them. Many parents simply, as you've said, don't know how to talk to them. I mean, I was talking to a woman recently. I had done some work with her daughter around getting her reading skills up. And in a very short amount of time, she made a lot of progress. And so the mother then said to me, well, I want to do that. I want to do that. I need to find a book. So I said, doesn't she have a room full of books? She's already got books. So that the idea of reading with her daughter became this huge Super Bowl halftime event that had to be planned, whereas actually it's very easy. Pull a book down, turn off your phone, and read. And I think that so many young kids are craving that attention because parents are ensnared by social media. Parents are addicted to social media. And so they can't, they're not good models for, well, turn your phone off. Well, you turn your phone off.
Right?
You're driving and texting mom. So there's a whole lot that needs to be done on the parental side in learning how to just, I think it's really simple and stupid. Pick up the book, turn off the phone, and read.
You know,
ask
what,
a hard question and wait for the answer.
And sometimes they ask what may be easy questions and you'll get a hard answer that you don't know what to do
with.
You know, one of the things that always bothers me is when, you know, you'll see a family going out to dinner or something, and each member of the family, including the child, they're stuck in their phones. That's not a gathering. That's like five separate people sitting in the same place. So putting limits on, even if you start with, you know, a decision that neither, that neither you or your child will look online, will pay attention to the phone during mealtime. I mean, eating together as a family is a lost art. Putting some limits on engagement with social media. There is such a thing as too much social media.
Oh yeah. That's proven. I mean, social media is this mixed bag. On the one hand, for example, there is the fact that it can actually increase isolation. It's funny because when I was doing the program and I talked to my grandson about social media, he said, Instagram, I don't go on Instagram. That's all fake. Everybody's light skin, everything, everybody's beautiful. So he could see, he's smart enough to see through the fake and the dangers of social media, but many children are not. And so social media on the one hand does isolate. It does present unrealistic visions of body and what life really is, that life is always being happy. Life is always at the beach. But on the other hand, and this is something I found very interesting that Dr. Recco Martin, who was on that program, mentioned. She said, well, you know, social media is always being criticized as isolating and alienating. But for many young people who live in communities, for example, where it can be quite dangerous to go outside, social media does offer community.
You know, that is very true. And certainly for disabled persons, depending on their disability, social media can offer community. I'd like to bring in the issue of bullying and social media.
Oh, please. Yes.
Because, you know, we all kind of have a sense of what bullying is. It is, I wish it were illegal. I don't think that it is yet, but you know, the difference between being the old days when you were bullied, typically at school, might even be somebody in your neighborhood, you could go home, you could go someplace else and not be confronted by that bully. Nowadays, bullying follows you 24/7 because you're online and people are being bullied online. They're being encouraged to engage in self-harm.
I think that it's easy to say to young people, well, just get off of Twitter. But if the platform has been designed to addict you, and it has been designed to addict you, that is the people who designed it study the psychology of how you addict people, the same way that cigarette makers did that with cigarettes. Mm-hmm. And so to just say, well, turn it off, it's simply not that easy. You shouldn't care. Well, but you do.
Right.
And so that when in the quote old days, you could just go home. But now because of the pull, the addictive pull, and it becomes something that is literally in your body as a automatic reaction, to say to someone, to a child, get off of it, because that's where your friends are. That's where all your friends are. So it's very, very complex, but at least we are having a conversation about it. But I have not seen, frankly, we've been having this conversation about social media for over a decade. It's dangerous, but I really haven't seen that much progress in policing it, because every time you talk about one social media platform, there's a new one.
Right.
Twitter. Oh, now there's TikTok. Then there's Snapchat. So that before you can monitor and get control of one, there's another three that are pulling you in. And so it really is a war for kind of the souls of our children.
Absolutely. And you know, I'm going to say something that will probably be sacrilegious for many, but if you want to really keep your child a tiny bit safer when dealing with social media, I think it's okay to take the phone or to take the laptop or the iPad, not forever, but for a period of time. It is okay to monitor what's going on for a period of time. Many people would be horrified to hear me suggest that you should maybe violate your child's privacy. And what I'm going to suggest is it's more horrifying not to know, and then your child comes to harm. And that doesn't mean you have to move into your child's bedroom and watch every single thing, but it's okay to put some limits, and then your child knows that you're interested, that you're concerned, and talk to your child and ask your child.
Exactly. Talk to them about what they're viewing.
That's right.
On social media. I mean, I know parents who just let their young children go on YouTube and look at anything.
Endlessly,
an endless loop. And you know, and then someone says, well, how would a five-year-old know how to kill themselves? YouTube.
That's right.
You know, so there's a lot that adults have to do. We have to get our own house straight.
Mm-hmm.
So before we, you know, can adequately deal with young people. And when we talk about normalizing conversations about mental health, that's really where I think we've got to get the ability to do that in ourselves. my books, Strong Black Woman, I've been doing a lot of coaching and conversation around that. And people said, well, how do you, I want my daughter to be very successful. And she's African American. So I've got to tell her, she's going to have to work 10 times harder. How can I raise her to be successful, but at the same time, care about her mental health, know that she has a right to peace of mind, relaxation, and joy. Mm-hmm. And I told this person, just as we were talked into believing that we had to work 10 times as hard, we couldn't show our emotions, we can talk our children into believing that, no, you don't have to work 10 times as hard. You have to work from your passion. Mm-hmm. You have to work from your joy. You have to work to be satisfied. But working 10 times as hard, we know from experience, is not necessarily going to get you where you want to be. And there's a great book that I want to suggest to everyone right now that I'm reading. It's called Rest is Resistance. Rest, R-E-S-T, is resistance. And it's written by Tricia Hersey, H-E-R-S-E-Y. And it's a manifesto about how and why we have to get off of the grind culture. Mm-hmm. The idea that the only reason we're living is to work, and the deleterious impact that has on us. So if we want to talk to our children about mental health, peace of mind, happiness, we have to believe that that's possible, and they have to see us engaging in those practices as part of a larger discussion about mental health. And I think that young people see so much on television, so much in movies, that they can handle discussions about, well, you know, Aunt Mary suffers from schizophrenia. My friend Betty suffers with depression. Those are conversations that they need to be engaged in with a competent adult, because their friends may be schizophrenic. Their friends may be depressed. So normalizing the conversation about mental health, so that they know that they can come to the parent, that the school counselor is not the only person that they can go to.
Marita, what I'd like to do, if you don't mind, is just to sort of run through some of the behaviors that may suggest that you want to take either yourself Please. Or your child in. Certainly, it for your younger children, if they weren't bedwetting before, but they are now, you want to take a look at that. Doesn't mean they're depressed or traumatized, but it might. Mm-hmm. If they're sucking their fingers and they had stopped. If they are less, certainly for the younger children, if they're less social than they used to be. Mm-hmm. For adolescents and older ones, has their clothing suddenly changed? Now that's a hard one, because adolescents' clothing gets every day.
Exactly. But
something really strange that's going on, really troublesome. Have their friends changed? Are they tearful? Have they lost energy? You know, a lot of the things that adults experience when they're dealing with depression, children do too. And we have to remember, again, not short adults, but human beings. Children get anxious. Adult might be anxious about paying a bill. Child might be anxious about passing a class, but the anxiety is there. If all of a sudden their daily habits change, you want to ask questions. Any change, you want to take a look at. Again, it doesn't mean that they're depressed or anxious, but it's reason to pause and get some more information. And, you know, what I say certainly to my clients all the time is be curious. Mm-hmm. Don't make assumptions, but be curious. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And let your child know the greatest gift you can give yourself, your loved ones, your children, is listening to what they're saying and what they're expressing.
Yeah, and moving heaven and earth to get the help they need. And I just want to, in line with that, the Washington Post, I think about a week and a half ago, published a really heartbreaking and very insightful, very deep profile of one little girl who survived the Uvalde shooting. And she was one of those little girls who was like the little magic super leader, always helpful, doing everything. And even after the shooting, because that was her default setting, because of her emotional resilience, she was there helping teachers in the aftermath. She was helping her friends. But at night, she could only sleep with her mother. She had to always know where her mother was, because she simply no longer felt safe. So then on the one hand, she remained the resilient, active little girl who ended up in Washington, D.C. To meet the president around this issue. But because of the trauma, become a little girl who could not sleep in her bed without her mother, who had to know where her mother was at all times. And the most heartbreaking part of that article was that the governor of Texas set up some sort of mental health headquarters for the people in the town, the mothers and fathers of these children. And when her mother went, nothing was available. I mean, the bureaucracy that you need to make that work had not been put in place. And then when she found therapy, it was $250 an hour. And so that little girl, at the end of that story, still had not gotten mental health care. Mm-hmm. And she survived the shooting, but she may be broken for life unless she gets the kind of support she needs. And that's a town that mental health resources should have just flooded that place.
Yeah.
But a fake bureaucracy, which was designed to quell the conversation about guns, was all they got. And it's just so, so tragic.
Absolutely. And it's so limiting. You know, I just want to sort of disagree with you about one thing. That child, it is true that that child could be very harmed and have great difficulties if she gets no help. Mm-hmm. On the other hand, over time, you know, people have written and studied it's hard to imagine, but the benefits of surviving a trauma. And mm-hmm. sometimes you can go through it and you can be more resilient. You know, I've worked with people who have had significant trauma histories and believe that because they had this trauma history, they are forever a victim. Mm-hmm. And that's not true mm-hmm. at all.
Great.
You can survive and you can grow and learn things about yourself and about the world around you. Some of them you may not like, but new learning is always a good thing.
Mm-hmm. Definitely. At this point, Sharita, do we have any questions?
We don't have any questions, but I just want to remind everybody to put any questions that you may have in the Q&A. But I would like to actually pose a question, just having listened to the conversation and reflected on all the things our youth have had to navigate, you know, over the last couple of years in particular. Some of the things they were navigating before, but everything just really got heightened. And, you know, my own son was 20 when the pandemic hit. So, you know, in the middle of college. But as I think about, you know, the youth that were younger than his age, and as they are sort of maturing into adulthood, like kind of what do you sort of suspect might be the long-term mental health impact on, you know, the young adult generation, you know, because of the things they've experienced during childhood? And so, you know, it's interesting. I was on a panel over the weekend and I heard someone refer to COVID as a great, a sort of a one time where we sort of have all experienced a disease that will actually cause mass disability. So either, you know, the impact of long COVID, so getting infected, mm-hmm. the physical manifestations of long COVID. And then of course, there's been the mental health impact of everything that's happened around COVID. You know, the pandemic wasn't just an infectious disease experience, but it was like there were other things happening. So what are the potential impacts as we think about those children who lived through that and their maturation into adulthood?
I would say that certainly there are some developmental things that they're not able to experience when they're in the house for 2 years. So what's the socialization like? That could become difficult. Doesn't mean that it can't be resolved, but you want to look for that. What is that child thinking, even that college student, about their own safety? Because now there are drills in from kindergarten to college about what to do if there's an active shooter. So you're kind of, you want to pay attention to the fact that that young child, that college student, could now have a sense of constant stress, a constant question about safety. So it'll be important to have conversations, I would say, of any age about what constitutes safety for that individual. What constitutes the sense of self-care for that individual? Because they could be impacted upon by just the experience, again, of being in the house for 2 years. And, you know, now you're supposed to, many places you're supposed to wear a mask all the time. Well, that's, what's the impact of that? What's the impact of covering your face from the nose down, if you're wearing it correctly, on that person's sense of self and that person's sense of safety? And really, what does that mean? What is that? Because we've not lived like that before. So I think that, you know, these little things that, quote unquote, little things that changed as a result of COVID, there, I think that it's important to look at what the long-term impact could be and not decide that if it's a little thing, that it really is a little thing.
Right.
I wonder if anybody is conducting those studies.
I think that there are people who are beginning to look at those studies. I don't know of any specific studies that are underway right now, but they certainly have to happen.
Mm-hmm.
Because, you know, COVID is around now.
It's still with us, yeah.
Yeah. So, you know, and even the conversations about who gets a shot, who gets a booster, you know, those are things that nobody had to worry about. Mm-hmm. You know, you either did or you didn't. But now with COVID, you know, the learning is that this could be literally life-threatening, life-ending. So how do you go through your life with that kind of, to two different people? So that one person's form of self-care is Lululemon in the gym, the hot gym, right? The new gym. And somebody else's self-care might be 10 minutes of silence when they get home.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
They're both self-care. So look at not the self-care that's quote unquote in or admired, but mm-hmm. the self-care that is actually you caring for yourself with the recognition that you need to care for yourself. You know, I've talked to clients who, you know, run the gamut, and how many times have I heard the women usually say, I don't have time for that, and they've got a long list of things they have time for. Well, maybe you have time for 5 minutes. I mean, we need to do work around why don't you have time for that, and how did you learn that you particularly as a woman don't have the right to have time for that? But while we're looking at that, let's just take a look realistically at what you've put in your life. You know, one of the exercises that I've used is to ask folks just to list all the things that they do. You can do it for a day or you can do it for a week. And how much time does it take? So how many minutes are there in a week? And how many minutes are you using? Are you applying to this thing? Well, invariably, you know, they're about 3 hours or 4 hours or 5 hours short of having time for their week that they currently have. So again, setting limits, setting boundaries, being realistic about what you can do, remembering that things take a process and that you have a right to direct that process. And, you know, it's true that it is what it is, right? So the single parent, he or she is a single parent. It is what it is.
Mm-hmm.
It's not good. It's not bad. It's real. So what's real for that individual? Maybe what's real for that individual is to give themselves permission to have, I don't know, pizza once a week. Oops, I didn't say that. That would be terrible, right? But maybe it's not so terrible. And also, you know, talking even within the family, what do these words mean? What does racism mean within the family?
Mm-hmm.
What's your child's experience of it? What's your experience of it? What does it mean to you? What does safety mean? Everybody assumes that these words mean the same thing. And so you can have a conversation with somebody even in your family and say, oh, I know what you mean. And really you don't.
Mm-hmm.
It goes back to the incredibly powerful practice of listening mm-hmm. with curiosity rather than judgment.
Mm-hmm. And I think the other thing now we've got moved from the single parent family to, okay, a two parent family, but you still don't have any time. You still don't have any time to take care of yourself.
Boundaries, setting limits.
Yeah, exactly. And I think that it's really like, for example, the woman who said to me, you know, I want my daughter to be really successful is the opposite of being a strong Black woman, a weak Black woman. And I often talk about how important it is to make your quest for mental health, relaxation, joy, and peace of mind a family project, to invest everyone in the family in your well-being and talk to them about their well-being as well. So that woman, she's going to be persuasive in talking to her daughter about, I want you to work hard, but I want you also to have downtime, if she does the same thing. Also, if she has said to her daughter, I'm going to a movie with my girlfriends on Saturday, take care of your younger brother. Not asking, but, you know, take care of your younger brother. I mean, when I was a single mother, I started a single parent support group. And once a month, we would get together. We would do nothing more adventurous than sit in someone's kitchen, eat pizza, chill, talk about our problems while our kids were playing. And it was enormously rejuvenating. And it made me feel less alone. Mm-hmm. And the other thing is we had that group intelligence thing going. So that if I couldn't solve a problem, somebody else had that same problem. But I'm a real advocate for training the whole family around mental health. That the father, he has a right to a day off too.
Mm-hmm.
The kids, everybody. So that what you're asking is not just something for yourself, but it's a lifestyle that ensures everybody's health and sanity.
You know, a couple of things just to add to that. The mother who really wants her daughter to be successful.
Mm-hmm.
Mother's got a view of what success means. Is it the same as daughter's? Find out what successful means to the daughter.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, in terms of making mental health, which is really whole body, whole person health,
mm-hmm.
A part of the family, if there's somebody in the family who says, no, how dare you, you should dare anyway. Over time, maybe they'll follow suit and maybe they won't. But you do you, because that's important and powerful. And as you said, Marita, you know, it's absolutely role modeling and lets the whole family know that, you know, you can take time for yourself. It's also great in terms of relationship modeling for your children, male and female, mm-hmm. that it's okay for you to say yes. It's okay for you to say no. You don't have to apologize. You can be true to yourself. And it's not the end of the world if you disappoint somebody.
And that prepares them for the world.
Yes.
It doesn't just prepare them for the family. It actually prepares them for the world. How in the world they can protect their integrity. They can protect their time. Maybe I was thinking the other day about, you know, how in so many office places now, you know, they're sort of giving people a break or a nap or whatever. And I was thinking, but what if you work at McDonald's? They give you a smoke break so you can go outside and fill your lungs with toxic poison.
Wow.
They give you an actual smoke break. And many restaurants, a smoke break, but a downtime break to just sit for 10 minutes and get off your feet. Oh, no. But a smoke break, yes.
So they get to be doubly unhealthy.
Yes.
Well, I think, you know, I've heard a couple of important points here as we're thinking about focusing on our children. So one is the importance of the role modeling. So, you know, role modeling what, you know, balance looks like so that as our children are growing into young adults, that they take that with them. And then also normalizing discussions around mental health during their childhood so that as they become young adults, that this is just a part of like their overall self-care. So really kind of normalize those conversations in the family, and even normalizing those conversations in the family may even help them recognize what's happening among some of their own peers who may need help or support. So, you know, I think those are all really critically important, you know, aspects of the discussion today.
My husband's son used to go to what he called the talking doctor.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
And I think he was 6 or 7.
Uh-huh.
And his mother, you know, would take him periodically to the talking doctor. And he would tell my husband what he and the talking doctor had talked about.
Right. So that's again, that's another way to normalize it and put it in terms that a child can identify with, and would even work for some adults also who maybe don't feel comfortable saying, I'm going to my psychologist or therapist, I'm going to, you know, the talking doctor. So,
yeah.
One of the things in terms of dealing with children is you really want to pay attention to their play. Because depending on the age of the child, that play can be not only powerful for the child, but really give parents a lot of insight into what's going on with that child. So what are they playing with? You know, if they're doing video games, what kind of games are they looking at? Monitor this stuff, pay attention to this stuff. It's all critically important. Mm-hmm.
Well, I am very grateful for this conversation. We don't have any more questions in the Q&A, but I think it's important for all of us to commit to saving our children. If there's a young person in your life and you're noticing the changes that we've talked about today, it's really critical to get them help. And, you know, I think that the other thing to be aware of is next week is Transgender Awareness Week, and Transgender Day of Remembrance will be celebrated next week, acknowledged next week, I should say. And, you know, we have to really recognize that for our children, you know, who are a part of the LGBTQ community, that there are just, they're really struggling right now because many states mm-hmm. have laws that are preventing the provision of gender affirming therapy and treatments for children. And so this is going to be another layer that we're going to have to think about, particularly in our sexual and gender diverse youth. So just keep that in mind. And I think those who are from underrepresented groups in particular, you know, transgender, Black transgender women are the group that experience the most violence. So yeah. That's just something to think about, you know, particularly for our transgender female youth. And again, you know, just being mindful of what they're experiencing right now because of some of the other legal decisions that are.
So
this so just we just want to kind of close with reminding everybody about that in light of the fact that we will be acknowledging that next week, and really want to thank Marita and Pamela for joining us and for this important dialogue. And I have my own copy of Saving Our Sons. So I'm very grateful for that. And, you know, it's called Saving Our Sons, but Saving Our Sons and Daughters and, you know, and all of our children, really, because they are our future.
So. One point that I'd just like to add before we close is the importance of all of us understanding that we matter. And letting our children and the people around us know that they matter to us. The power of just taking a child's face in your hands, if you're able to do that, and just looking at that child and say, you matter to me. Or looking at yourself in the mirror and say, you matter to me. And then if you matter to me, if I matter to me, how would I do my day? If I really mattered to me, would I do what I'm doing or would I do something different? Those can be really powerful conversations to have with yourself and others.
All right. Well, thank you very much.
Thank you.
To remind everybody, in January, we will have our writing workshop with Marita. And, you know, this will be like the beginning of a new year. And, we'll be doing it during our MLK commemoration week. So it's time to refresh and rejuvenate and think about how you want to move forward into the new year. So we look forward to that. So we wish everyone a happy Thanksgiving, Merry Christmas, Happy Hanukkah, Happy New Year, because all those things will happen in the next few weeks. So
amazing.
Thank you very much.
Thank you, Sharita.
Thank you.
All right. So let me start recording. We